Just recently, on the 29th of May, 2021, a small plane crashed right outside of Smyrna, Tennessee. This plane was heading to Palm Beach, Florida, and carried members of the Remnant Fellowship Church. One of these members was the founder, Gwen Shamblin Lara. In her life, Gwen Shamblin Lara was a very controversial figure in the Christian and in the diet communities. I personally had experience with her Way Down workshop and honestly was very affected by her sudden death. But before we go any further, you know what to do. Please hit that subscribe button and give us a like. Also, as always, a very, very special thank you to all of our patrons. We truly could not do this channel without you. If you would like to join our Patreon community, there is a link down in the description box below. Welcome to Esoteric Atlanta. My name is Bryce, and today we are going to be talking about the weight loss guru. First of all, I still am down in Florida, hence why the background looks a little bit different. But because of Gwen Shamblin Lara's sudden death, I did feel the need to go ahead and film this video while she was heavily on my mind. I do want to say that even though there was a lot of controversy around her weight loss plan and around her church, I have nothing but good memories of Gwen Shamblin Lara. However, I will be sharing some of the controversy and some of the negative stuff regarding her as well, to be fair and to be non-biased. At the end of this segment, I'm also going to be including an interview with my own mother who did Gwen's weight loss program. That is how I got familiar with the program Way Down through our church back in the 90s when I was a kid. And her theories around weight loss have been something that have affected me into my adult life. Gwen Shamblin Lara was born on the 18th of February, 1955 in Memphis, Tennessee. I personally love her accent. It's an old Southern accent. And she, in the 90s, reminded me a lot of like my friend's parents. Gwen was raised in an upper middle class family. Her family was very well educated. Her father was a surgeon. Just like me, Gwen grew up in a very medically based family. She got her undergraduate degree in dietetics from the University of Tennessee, where my own grandfather went to school. And then she got her master's in food and nutrition from Memphis State University. As many people will tell you, even those who are critical of her diet plan, this woman was very, very well educated. She understood food. She was a faculty member at Memphis State University for about 5 years. She also worked in the secular world as a dietitian. And she also worked for the health department of Memphis. And of course, she was also a member of the American Dietetic Association. Gwen married her first husband, David Shamblin, in 1978. She was 22 years old at the time. Together, her and David have two children, Michael Shamblin and Elizabeth Shamblin Hannah, and between their two children, they have seven grandchildren. In 2018, David and Michael got divorced. According to one source I found, the reasons for the divorce was that they had opposing opinions on certain things, and it was hinted that allegedly Gwen was already in a relationship with Joe Lara, who would go on to become her second husband, whom then she would marry again in 2018. Because of the timing of this all, I do believe there probably was a little bit of a relationship happening before the divorce and might have been a reason, one of the reasons for the divorce, but this is just speculation on my part. For me, that's their business, not my business, but a lot of people have had an issue with this because Gwen ran a church. Now, her second husband, Joe Lara, unfortunately did pass away with Gwen in this plane crash that happened on the 29th of May. Gwen's son-in-law, Brandon Hannah, also passed away, her daughter Elizabeth's husband, and my heart truly goes out to the family, especially Elizabeth. I can't imagine losing your mom and the father of your children, your husband, all in one swoop. That must be totally devastating, and I really have had that family in my thoughts and prayers. Now, Joe Lara, her second husband, was also kind of famous. He apparently was in some adaptation of Tarzan many years ago, but you know, it is what it is. I didn't know who he was until I started researching him, but he had some screen time. Now, from what I understand, after David and Gwen got divorced, David was still an active member in the Remnant Fellowship Church that Gwen had established in 1999. And again, from what I understand, he is the one who released her obituary once her death had been confirmed. So with Gwen Shamblin Lara, from the very beginning of her work in the weight loss community, things, in my opinion, seem pretty healthy. But there is a part in her timeline where things do tend to get a little bit weird. As I said earlier, I have a very positive experience with Gwen, but I can understand why others might see Gwen as a CULT leader as of the time of her death, and we're going to get into that. So let's start with the origins of the Way Down workshop. So I want to note before we get into the Way Down workshop that according to a study done by Duke University, evangelical Christians tend to be the most overweight, with Baptists scoring the highest. I saw somebody else talk about this, and I think this is really important to bring up for many, many, many different reasons. First of all, it was the evangelical Christians that really embraced Gwen Shamblin Lara's Way Down workshop. And second of all, because we are talking about fundamentalism and also evangelicalism, on top of that, we need to understand that being overweight or being underweight is a sign of an imbalance. Now, somebody else who is speaking about this workshop just recently brought up the fact that it appears that evangelical Christians, mostly women, tend to eat their feelings. To me, this means that there is a higher rate of imbalance with food addiction among conservative Christians. Again, I have my own opinions behind that as we looked at Bill Gothard, and Bill Gothard is extremely extreme compared to Gwen Shamblin's church. Again, we'll get into that a little bit later. But when you're forced to feel like you have to be perfect and you have to be pleasantly sweet or joyfully available, especially as a woman, and maybe that your own emotions and your own feelings aren't recognized as valid compared to that of your husband or your brother, there can then be some habits developed by an individual to try to soothe that within themselves. And seeing that most of these extremely conservative groups tend to not drink or do other types of substances, food is the next best solution. So it absolutely makes sense that there would be a higher rate of obesity amongst evangelical Christians and fundamentalist Christians. But of course, weight issues run through all different demographics and walks of life. It is not exclusive, of course, to evangelical Christians. It's just an interesting phenomenon to observe. So in the 1980s, Gwen started weight control private consultations for her work. Again, this is what she had her undergraduate degree in, as well as her master's in. This is obviously something that Gwen was born to do. She was very fascinated by the way the human body works and the way the human body works with food. She developed the Way Down workshop program in 1986 while she was getting her master's in food and nutrition. According to Gwen, she gained about 20 pounds while she was in school. Of course, we know that's normal. The freshman 15, we always see college students gain a little bit of weight when they're finally on their own. They have weird sleeping hours. They're not getting nutritious home-cooked meals from their mother. They're now getting like pizza and beer and all sorts of stuff. So this is typically common. Now, according to Gwen herself, she had tried countless diets of the 80s. Now, I was born in 1983, and I feel like I catapulted into life during this whole like low-fat jazzercise era of our timeline. In fact, I remember my mother doing jazzercise. I remember going to big gymnasiums where they were teaching jazzercise classes and sitting in the back corner while my mother did her classes. I also remembered Richard Simmons. Y'all remember Richard Simmons? And I actually went and looked on YouTube and found an old Richard Simmons workout video, and I actually did it a couple of days ago, and I had so much fun. I remember my mother would do his videos all the time, and I really enjoyed Richard Simmons, and he had such a fun outlook on exercise, and that's something that I try to incorporate into my exercise. I exercise a lot, is to have fun and to always enjoy it. If you guys are interested in checking out Richard Simmons' workout videos, I have put the link down in the description box below because it is a lot of fun. He's a fun guy. So after Gwen tried all these countless diets in the 80s, she became convinced that there was more to being naturally thin than just behavior modification and the lucky genes. She believed that everybody was naturally thin, but some had lost their way. Her diet focuses on waiting until you're physically hungry to eat, so actual stomach pains, growling pains, and then eating whatever you want. Now, in the beginning, she teaches you to cut your food in half. So let's say that you're craving McDonald's. Let's pick one of the most unhealthy meals that you can pick. So let's just say that you've spent your whole life starving yourself, going on these crazy diets, and all of a sudden you're doing this weigh down program where the instructor is basically teaching you how to relearn how to listen to your body when your body needs food. That food is fuel. And so you start doing weigh down, you get up in the morning and you're waiting for your stomach to physically start to growl. Your stomach physically starts to growl, so you can eat whatever you want now, whatever you're craving. So you decide that on the first day of your weigh down, you're going to go to McDonald's and you're going to get a Big Mac and fries and a Coca-Cola, not a Diet Coke, a real Coke with all the sugar. So you go over to McDonald's, you get your meal, you come home, you spread your meal out. So what you have to do now is cut everything in half. So you take a knife, you cut your hamburger in half, you take the fries, you cut those in half, and you toss the other half away, or you put it away and save it for later, and you just eat half of the meal. Once you're finished, you then now wait until you're hungry again to eat. Now, according to Gwen, over time, you won't have to cut your meal in half because you will learn how to eat until you're satisfied, not overly stuffed, but until your body feels satisfied. Gwen said that part of her research is she started to invite her naturally skinny friends out to lunch, and she would observe them eating. They would go out to these meals and they would order what they want to eat. And Gwen said, I'm paraphrasing, she would say that she would just gobble up everything on her plate and she would watch her friend would eat some of this, some of that, and then be done. And Gwen would say, why didn't you eat your mashed potatoes? You didn't finish them. Did you not like them? And her friend would say, oh, no, 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 I loved them. They were great. I'm just full. And it started to occur to Gwen that there are people that still remember how to eat for their body. Her weigh down program basically was a program that taught people how to eat to live instead of live to eat. I think this is genius. This is part of what I do now, except for I know for myself with the Ayurvedic side of it that I'm a Vata Pitta. So my disposition on Vata means that my first sign of hunger is I start to space out. For me, hunger pains come way later. And if I don't eat when I start to space out, by the time hunger pains come, it's bad news bears. I'm usually feeling like I'm going to throw up. So different body types, different dispositions have different mechanisms to tell them when to eat. Gwen also stated that you eat what you're craving, that your body knows what it wants. And if that's a brownie, that's a brownie. In her interview with Larry King, she even said that her God is the God of brownies, that God created food for us to enjoy, not to worship, but to savor and enjoy. Now, at first, Gwen started holding small classes on way down in her consultant office in Memphis. And from what I understand, at first, this way, even though Gwen herself was a Christian and was a member of a Church of Christ church, the way down first originally originated not necessarily as a Christian diet, but as basically just relearning how to eat. By 1992, Gwen started holding classes at the Bellevue Baptist Church in Tennessee. This would be considered a mega church today, and it is one of the leading churches in the Southern Baptist Convention. At this point, we see the program starting to become God-focused, which is fine because I am a believer in God. I believe God did give us signs to show us when it's time to refuel ourselves. And I also believe that God wants us to enjoy food and not think that certain foods are off limits because they're bad or whatever. But basically, this idea started to form that if you eat outside of the boundaries of your own physical hunger, then you are committing a sin. Now, I don't really know about that. I don't know if it would be considered a sin. I do believe that if you're eating to excess and you're overweight, then you are hurting yourself. And I heard the awesome Brenda from God is Gray had said that she believes sin. Again, I'm paraphrasing what she said. She believes sin is something that you do to hurt yourself or hurt other people. And I agree with her that if you're overeating to that point, then you are hurting yourself and that is not good. And on the opposite scale, starving yourself too, it's always hurting yourself. But as I said, there are incidents where you're going to be needing to eat when you're not physically hungry. Diabetics, for example, sometimes have to eat something when they're not physically hungry because their body needs that fuel. Now, this first group at the Bellevue Baptist Church was a 12-week program that was taught by Gwen through videotapes and audio tapes. And I did find some of the videotapes from the 90s that I watched them. There are five of them listed in the description box below. Back when things were a little bit normal with the Way Down Workshop, back when I was introduced to it through my mother. By 1994, there were 60 churches in 35 states and some churches in Europe that started to host the Way Down classes. By 1995, the next year, there was 1,000 churches in 49 states. By 1996, there were 5,000 churches across the United States hosting the Way Down workshops. And by this point, the Way Down workshop had a staff of about 40 people and was big enough and successful enough to build a headquarters in Franklin, Tennessee. In 1997, Gwen wrote her book, The Way Down Diet. She said that eating basically has two purposes, one for fuel, and the second was for emotional need. One is a sin, according to Gwen, and one is not. She uses the example of a chocolate cake. Two people could be eating a chocolate cake, one could be sinning, and one could not be sinning. One could be eating the chocolate cake because they're actually hungry and that's what they craved. And one could be eating it just because it tastes good and they want to fill an emotional need. Now, I can understand this. If you're eating to fill an emotional need, you definitely need to become aware of that and observe that. I think a lot of us do this. When I get really stressed out or emotional, typically I don't eat. I'll typically forget to eat. But sometimes I do find myself eating out of boredom. If I'm just bored, I'll go get a freaking snack. That's not good either. Now, Gwen said that you need to start focusing on God. Like if you feel a craving to eat, but you're not hungry, then just go on your knees and start praying and really make your life God-focused. And that will help you to start to understand your hunger pains and relearning the gift of your body that God gave you. And again, yes, your body is a gift. Sometimes when we follow restrictive diets or we overexercise, we're punishing ourselves and not loving ourselves. I see this in my industry all the time. When I see people come into the yoga Mysore Shala room and start overdoing it, it's like they're beating themselves up versus celebrating what their body can actually do. Now, I believe, even though I believe you can pray and you can have God help you, I also believe in therapy. If you find that you are eating to excess and you can't control it and you're realizing that you have a food addiction, start praying, but also try to find a counselor that can help you work through that, because there's a reason why you're doing that. And you need to understand that and process that in order to let it go. This is one of the biggest issues that I have with evangelical and fundamentalist Christians. Of course, not all of them. This is just a generalization. I know there are plenty conservative Christians out there that do believe in therapy, but a lot of them don't. And I know in my church growing up that if somebody had cancer, then the congregation would pray for that person and pray for the doctors that were working with that person to help cure them. But when it comes to any type of mental imbalance, we see a lot of churches poo-poo therapy and just think you need to pray it away. And that's not good. People need therapy as well, and I believe that God wants us to seek that kind of help if we need it. So by 1998, there were 21,000 classes and 250,000 participants across the world. Across the world, guys, 250,000 people across the whole world were participating in the Way Down workshops, and they were having such success. My mother had a lot of success with Way Down back in the 90s when she did it through our church. Again, I'll let her tell you about that when I talk to her at the end of this segment. In 1998, Gwen was also named the Christian Business Leader of the Year by Lipscomb University. And around this time, we also see Gwen become a media sensation. And it's easy to see why she became a media sensation. She's a cute Southern woman. She's very well spoken. And her diet is one that promises you that you can get rid of excess weight forever and finally end your addiction to food and be able to eat whatever you want for the rest of your life. Now, I also want to mention that Christian dieting programs became big in the 1970s. And if you guys want me to do an episode full of all the Christian diets out there from this time period, I will be more than happy to do that. I looked into some of them. Like, there was an old Christian diet that was like eat how Jesus ate, and it was following the Mediterranean diet because that's how Jesus would have eaten. Now, again, different body types, different blood types, all that kind of stuff is going to require a different diet depending on what your body needs, but that was just one of the examples. Now, some of the old Christian diets would borrow from old Jewish dietary laws, and of course, they all kind of taught generally that being overweight was a sin. So from my look into different diets labeled Christian diets, I do think Gwen's was probably the most healthy one. And really, any person out of any faith, even if you're an atheist, could benefit from Gwen's diet, because it's literally just common sense of being able to listen to your body, and when your body tells you it's hungry, to then eat what your body's craving and not to overeat what your body's craving. So around this time, the first big controversy happened with Gwen, and this was involving the Trinity. So Gwen, as a Christian, publicly denounced the Trinity. This was first done in an email that was sent out to about 40,000 people who were associated with the Way Down workshop through their churches. Now, I do want to note that Gwen still did believe that Jesus was the Son of God, and she still did believe in the Holy Spirit. She just didn't believe in the triad of all three in one. She claimed this because she said it was not mentioned in the Bible as there being a Trinity. And from my research, this is still a common belief at Remnant Fellowship Church. For a laid-back Christian like myself, this is more of a tomatoes type of things. We're all entitled to our own opinions and our own interpretation of the Bible. However, for evangelical Christians that are maybe are not so laid back, this was kind of a nail in the coffin for the Way Down workshops being hosted in a lot of these churches. There was also Christian publishing houses that were publishing her books that dropped her because of this statement about the Trinity, and she ended up forming her own publishing company so she could publish her own work. So part of me wonders if Gwen had been able to maintain her Way Down workshop in all these churches, even though they knew that she didn't believe in the Trinity but was still a Christian. If she was able to kind of maintain a relationship with these churches, would she have gone off the deep end? I don't know. But it does seem around this 1999 mark where things start to shift into like the kooky. Now, I do have a problem with churches being like, you can't have your workshop here because you don't believe exactly what we believe. I have a problem with that too. That to me is very cult-like. And even though she didn't believe in the Trinity, but other evangelical churches did, I mean, again, tomatoes, tomatoes, she's still a Christian. She still believed in Jesus. She still prayed to the same God they prayed with. So why, I just don't understand why this was such a big deal. I know that people in the comment section are probably going to yell at me for saying that, because sometimes some of these conservative churches tend to be a little bit more on the violent side when it comes to people who think differently than they do. But again, people are all entitled to their own opinions. They're entitled to their own interpretation. And just because someone doesn't believe exactly what you believe does not mean that their relationship with God is invalid. So it was around this time that Gwen opened up her own church, the Remnant Fellowship Church. And again, this is where things get a little kooky and things get a little weird. And there's perhaps some CULT practices happening in this church. Now, the Remnant Church was originally built, from my own research and from what I understand, to be an extension of the Way Down workshop. It seemed that with this little nugget of an idea of how to eat your food, how to live life as a human being, eating food could also be practiced in other areas of your life as well. If you're tired, you sleep. If you're fighting another addiction, use the same principles as Way Down Workshop. And therefore, this whole theory started to really become the cornerstone of her belief system with this church, again, from what I understand. Now, according to members or ex-members of the Remnant Fellowship Church, there are a lot of practices within the church that do score high on the BITE model, which we went over with Bill Gothard, which is behavior control, thought control, emotional control, intellectual control, just highly controlled groups. Now, because I'm not a member of the Remnant Fellowship Church, I did try to watch some of the services that were recorded, but of course, when you're watching a recorded service, sometimes you don't know if you're actually getting the full story because it is recorded. So I am going to ask if there's anybody out there that was a member of this church, you had experiences with this church, good or bad, please reach out to me. I would love to talk to you. Now, in 2002, Gwen purchased 40 acres of property and she donated it to her church to build her church. And then in 2004, the Brentwood location opened. So let's kind of look at some of these CULT claims from other people and their recorded experiences at the church. Now, something very different about Remnant Fellowship Church and the IBLP or Bill Gothard or even Steve Anderson that we spoke about a couple of weeks ago is that there isn't a lot of what I can see as modesty. So from the outside looking in, it looks like a church, just a normal church like any of us would go to. You see many pictures of Gwen in like halter tops and tank tops, and they wear makeup and pants. They apparently do drink at special occasions, so very modern in that respect. They also allow divorce, obviously, because Gwen herself had a little something allegedly going on with Tarzan, with Joe Lara, and so left her original husband for him. So there's some normalcy, some secular normalcy in this church that, again, probably would have been hidden or just not allowed in some of the more fundamentalist churches. So some ex-members have claimed that Gwen called herself a prophet. I could not find any footage of her saying this openly, but there have been claims made by ex-members. I did hear a speech that her daughter gave where she called her an oracle, so maybe that might be what they're referring to. They claimed that Gwen did not believe that the gospel was taught at its entirety at churches, which I do agree with her on because we know there are missing books of the Bible. However, Gwen believed that allegedly she had the full knowledge of the Gospels. I don't agree with that because, as you know, on this channel, we're all together trying to figure this out. Nobody has the answers. We're just all trying to work together to figure out what was taken out of the Bible and what was held back from us. People claim that she preyed on vulnerable people who really wanted to lose weight. And so when they started to do her Way Down workshop, which really was just, again, listening to their own bodies and learning how to reread their bodies, she was able to then manipulate them into joining her church. This could potentially be seen as a form of spiritual manipulation, like, oh, look, at this magic that happened through my teaching, my counseling, my program. Now you've gotten skinny again, so you really should come to our church because then your whole life is going to be perfect, that kind of stuff, if you know what I mean. And again, these are all alleged claims. Some claims that if you left the church, then you were shunned, like in Scientology or, again, other organizations that start with a C. Some even claimed that members who left the church were then designated as, like, carrying the mark of the beast by Gwen herself. And then there was a website called SpiritWatch. Now, SpiritWatch dropped a 50-page report claiming that this church, this Remnant Fellowship Church, met all the requirements to be a C-U-L-T. This was an article written by Adam and Maria Brooks. I have included a link down in the description box below. They said that they had a wonderful experience initially through the Way Down program, and because of that, they felt pressured to join Gwen's church. They felt that there were mind control tactics being used that you see in a lot of high demand religious groups. And they claimed that they were taught that if they ate outside of their own hunger, that they were crossing a boundary set by God, and that this was leading them to, like, excessive sin and damnation. They also claimed that Remnant Fellowship Church practices fasting a lot. Now, this is not uncommon in churches or any spiritual organization. In yoga, we fast. It's really very common, but they are saying that this was excessive. And a lot of the claims against Gwen with her diet program says that it can lead to eating disorders like anorexia. Hence why I keep saying there needs to be a therapist involved in this process. Because yes, there is value into listening to your body when your body needs to eat. However, if it gets to the point where you're ignoring it, you have some delusional thought in your head that it's because God is putting this boundary on you, then you definitely need to get a therapist involved. There was also a court case that had to do with child ABUSC in Atlanta, Georgia, where I'm from, and this became called the glue stick case. This was Georgia versus Smith. A Georgia couple by the name of Joseph and Sonia Smith were tried and convicted of killing their 8-year-old son through corporal punishment that they claimed, or their claims have been made, was taught to them through Remnant Fellowship Church. In October of 2003, an 8-year-old child by the name of Joseph was rushed to Children's Hospital of Atlanta after his family called 911. According to his family, he passed out while they were about to attend a prayer session online with their church, which was Remnant Fellowship Church. Once at the hospital, he was declared brain dead. Doctors found that he had suffered ongoing ABUSE and was often hit with glue sticks. It is alleged that the parents learned about glue sticks from their church because it was believed that glue sticks would not leave a mark. Parents were arrested and Remnant Fellowship Church posted their bond. Gwen also stated they would be taking care of their legal bills as they believed the parents were innocent. In June of 2004, the church was raided as part of the investigation into the child's death. Nothing was found in the church that would include the church in the charges. The police claimed that there was no link between Remnant Fellowship Church and this case. Again, the parents were found guilty of felony murder on the 16th of February 2007, which ironically was their son's 12th birthday. So in conclusion of this section, is this a C-U-L-T? Maybe. Did it turn into one? Probably. But do we throw the baby out with the bathwater? No. Again, there's a lot about Gwen Shamblin Lara that is concerning, but there's also a lot about her teaching that is really, really valuable in my opinion. Her common sense approach to eating and relearning your body is something that we all need to do. Again, especially when it comes to exercise. Now, interesting to note that with the Way Down workshop, if you don't want to exercise, if you hate exercising, then you don't have to. And I agree. Exercise, any type of exercise you do should be seen as fun. You should not be out there at the gym, at your yoga studio, at your dance studio, running on a trail, whatever it is you do, you should not be doing that to try to beat yourself up or excessively burn calories. You should be celebrating your body. I love exercising. I exercise 6 days a week, hardcore exercise 6 days a week, and I love it. I celebrate it. When I teach my students, when they're doing something really hard in their own practice, I try to remind them that this work is a gift and that it's fun to see what your body can do and that your body can do it, instead of the other way around, where you need to do it to burn calories or get fit and strong. The body is an organism that's always shifting, growing, and changing. And therefore, the root, the crux of this Way Down workshop, in my opinion, is super valuable, because our bodies are a gift and they're all very different and very unique. And we are the people, we are the spirits that get to inhabit these human bodies and experience sensation through them. And so her approach to eating what you want to eat that you crave and exercising only if you enjoy it, to me, is spot on. Now again, did it cross a line and go into excessive? Probably. Do you need to have a therapist on call to help you with food addictions? Absolutely. But again, my opinion, we cannot throw the baby out with the bathwater. I also once more wish the family lots of peace during this trying time. Please do not reach out to them. Please do not harass them. And coming up next, an interview with my mother on her experience with the Way Down workshop.
Yeah, okay. Hit continue.
Yeah, I mean, are you seeing I just hit record. I don't think you have to do anything.
Okay.
Because I'm recording.
It says it's recording.
Yeah, I think you're good. Okay. All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the second part of this episode about the passing of Gwen Shamblin, Lara. Now, as I said in the first part, I have very mixed feelings about Gwen and whether or not she was a CULT leader or just somebody who had some controversial views on the Christian faith and on dieting. Now, this is my mother. Y'all know my mother. She's been on the channel before. And I was familiar with Gwen Shamblin Lara because my mother did the Way Down program in the 90s, back when it was really popular amongst a lot of evangelical churches. And I remember my mother talking about it, and we spoke about that in the first part of this video about what it entailed. And so I had always kind of good memories of Gwen. So I was really shocked when these accusations came up about her church, the Remnant Fellowship Church. Now, Mom, I will say, don't say the C word, C-U-L-T, because okay, we too will take
I'll
this
be
video
careful.
Down.
Right.
So Mom, I know most people know you because you've done shows on this channel before,
yeah,
but before leading up to Way Down, can you give everybody kind of a history of like dieting you did or growing up in the 80s when jazzercise was big and all that kind of stuff?
Sure. Well, I was born chubby. So I started the diet route really at a young age. I can remember even being in the middle school and, you know, we'd go on crash diets. So it's something that I've struggled with my whole life. I've tried everything, Weight Watchers, Way Down, Atkins, you know, tried them all. And so it was in the late 90s, and my church was sponsoring this Way Down group for weight loss. And so I decided, you know, I'd had two children, I needed to get some weight off, and thought, well, that would be a great way because we would have support. You know, you go to these meetings, you have other people that are struggling like you are. And so we did her Way Down series. And if I recall, it was a video series that we did. We had a book and she had a video series. And the program really and truly, actually, I really liked it, and I need to do it again because it really is similar to what the intermittent fasting programs are today that most doctors are really, you know, suggesting we do. In fact, it's very similar. Her philosophy was that God didn't intend for us not to enjoy the foods that He has provided for us. And, you know, we should be able to enjoy food, but of course it's all about portion control. And that was the main thing. But her philosophy was that you would you would not eat until you got really hungry. And when I mean really hungry, I mean not up here hungry, but where your stomach was actually growling, you know. And so you were to wait till your stomach started growling before you could eat. And sometimes that took a good part of the day, which is basically intermittent fasting. And then when you do eat, she said, eat what you want, but half it. So if I wanted to eat, I'll never forget one day I would go get a Subway sandwich, because, you know, that was when Subway was huge. And I would go get a Subway sandwich and a bag of chips. And I would, you know, get this, the regular, not the big one. And I would split it in half, and I would half my bag of chips, and I would eat half of it for lunch. And then I would wait until my stomach growled again, and I would eat the other half. So it wasn't a lot of calories in a day. I mean, you know, but it gave me the freedom, to eat what everybody else was eating and not worry about it. I remember one time, I don't know if you remember this, Bryce, but we were driving to the beach, and you remember sweet Linda, who would come to the beach with us, who I just adore. So Linda was driving with us. I think your dad had, you know, he couldn't always come because of work. But anyway, so we were driving, and I remember just very distinctly, on the way, it was, y'all were starving, and my stomach was growling, and we pulled into a fast food restaurant, and I remember ordering a hamburger and french fries and cutting it in half, getting half the fries out and eating it. And I lost a bunch of weight doing that, you know. So she did have scripture to back up her ideas. She would have scripture to back up her ideas. And, you know, but her whole philosophy was just really not overeating. Now, she got real thin, and I think as the years went on, it kind of maybe her changed a little bit, but I actually like the program. And since she's been doing this, and since it's been in the news, I've been thinking, you know, I probably need to go back to doing that to get my COVID off.
We'll have to leave that word out, because we can't say that word either.
Oh,
that's okay.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I'm sorry.
So the viewers of YouTube. Yeah. That's okay. Well, that's what I talked about in the beginning of this. And I actually found, Mom, I went and found 5 of her videos. From the 90s.
Oh, really?
I watched
really?
Them all, and I'm placing them in the description box for people.
Okay, I'll have to go back and look at them.
And as I said, I remember you saying this as well, because I was like in middle school or high school. I was old enough to like comprehend what you were saying. And basically her whole philosophy, she is, as I said, part one of this. She's a smart lady. She was a nutritionist. She had her master's in food nutrition. So she had studied all these diets in the 80s. So I learned too that the fad of Christian dieting came out in the 1970s. And there's some really funny diets out there that I've asked the channel if they want me to cover. I'll cover, because they're kind of funny. But then in the 80s, I said that, you know, being born in 1983, I was kind of catapulted into life during a timeline where low-fat dieting was really big, and jazzercise. I remember you were always running or doing jazzercise. Mm-hmm. And I actually found Richard Simmons' video that I'm putting in the description, because I remember you would do it.
Yeah, hey, I loved him.
And Richard Simmons, I loved rewatching him, and I did his video for fun, because he expressed exercise as being fun. And being joyous versus like beating yourself up. And I remember that I remember in Way Down, did she say, if you don't want to exercise, you don't have to exercise? That was kind of philosophy, you should enjoy your life.
Yes.
And not be.
It was, and you know, really to lose weight, it really is about what you put in your mouth. Exercising makes you feel better. And I'm a big proponent, as you know, of exercising just to strengthen your body and your muscles. And I think it's good for your mentally too, but you can't outrun your weight.
Right.
You know what I mean? You have to watch what you eat. I mean, that's the bottom line. But I had recently done a Richard Simmons video too. And, you know, he catered to the very overweight and the elderly, which was nice. You know, he wanted everybody to be able to enjoy exercising. But
And it was this idea of having fun, which I've kind of changed my thinking about exercise, where it's a chance to utilize your body versus beating yourself up to burn calories.
Exactly.
I remember you talking about, like, when I was in high school, one of my favorite movies was Swing Kids. Remember that movie, Swing Kids?
Oh, yeah.
About about the the kids, this group of kids during World War II in Germany, and their way to rebel against the government was to dress in British clothing and go to these clubs and swing dance to American music, which was obviously illegal in Germany during that time. And I remember you saying at one point, like, this is why my parents were always skinny, is because their generation, they danced and they didn't have they were active and they didn't have the microwave and the instant foods. Cooking was more of a process than we have easy access. So you do see this like change happening in the middle of the 20th century where weight seems to become more of an issue than maybe it was before. Of course, there were overweight people at that, but it really became like a huge issue because our lifestyle had changed. And so you see this immediate, like the pendulum swings where people start starving themselves, doing exercising, jazzercise, which is fun too. And now I think the world has a way healthier view of that now than back then. But I do, and I said this in the video, like, I do think that she had, I don't think we should throw the baby out with the bathwater, because I think she really understood, like, some everybody's naturally skinny, it's just some people have lost their way. Now, I want to ask you some about her religious beliefs and ask you what you believe, because we have been studying on this channel and on David's channel some of these more fringe Christian, like C-U-L-T's, like the, especially since the Josh Duggar stuff came out about Bill Gothard, really. And we grew up, I've said this before, we grew up very conservative Christian, but we were progressively liberal compared to like the Duggar and their belief system. And with Gwen Shamblin, the thing about her church is that you don't see modesty culture. She wore halter tops. People wore jeans. They drank. So there's some differences there. Now, the first thing I want to ask you is towards the end, or towards the time where she got a little kooky and things kind of got a little weird, she started to really preach that to eat when you're not hungry, to eat outside of the boundaries of hunger, was a sin. Do you believe that's true?
Hunger is the sin. Oh, no, 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 no.
No, no, to eat outside. Like, if you eat when you're not hungry.
Oh, no. No, no, no.
She really thought that was a sin.
And that, you know, that's extreme. You know, I think God put food on this earth for us to enjoy. I mean, sometimes you just, you know, you just want to enjoy food. And I don't think that's a sin at all. And, you know, hunger, that's no, I do not believe that at all. Because you know what? Some people honestly have like hypoglycemia. Your sister has a little bit of that. And, you know, when she would not eat for a period of time, she would get sick.
The Ayurveda. So what the things that Gwen, the foundation of her teaching, waiting, like really learning common sense, like really learning how to listen to your body. And she taught that the stomach physically growls. Now, if you mold that into like an Ayurvedic approach, which we've talked about, because we're different doshas, you have three dispositions of people. Now, someone who's kapha based, which is what you are, they can wait until their stomach physically growls. They're really good about going long periods of time without eating. But my sister and me, we're both vata-based. Vata-based people, the first sign of hunger is we start to space out. We start to get like space.
But your blood sugar drops probably.
By the time our stomach is, by the time my stomach growls, it's bad news bears. I feel like I'm going to throw up. And so I've learned, so if you take Gwen's, If you look at her message as waiting till your stomach growls is super strict, then that's not going to be good for people who are Vata. So if you can kind of see the gray there, and that some people, like you learn, like when I, like before I do long interviews, I might not be spacey, but I will eat something. Like when I do David shows, sometimes I'm on for 2 hours. I need to eat something so I don't space out while I'm talking to him. So that's a big difference there that could get people into some trouble if they're not a kapha-based person. You also look at people who are diabetic. If they have like
father,
they might not be hungry, but sometimes they have to eat something to do with managing that blood. And so now I also found an interesting study as I was looking into this. Somebody else brought this up who had done way down on another video. And she had mentioned that evangelicals are like really high in like being obese. And I looked into it, and there is a study from Duke University where evangelicals tend to be the most obese, overweight, and the Baptists are the highest. And she, this woman reckoned that it was because a lot of evangelical women especially have the tendency to eat their emotions. especially if you're looking at more like conservative or fundamentalist views of the woman's place, mm-hmm. that she's trying to hide a lot of what, and so that she starts eating her emotions. Do you agree with that?
I eat my emotions, but I don't think it has anything to do with my religion. And, you know, possibly too, because they're in the kitchen a lot. Their view on serving their family and serving their husbands and all too, they may just be cooking a lot. Therefore they're around food a lot, but, no, I'm very conservative and I have a great relationship with the Lord, but I also am very, I'm not extreme like that.
Yeah.
I just think sometimes those extreme views can really be dangerous and, you know, but that's interesting about that. That would be a good study to find out why is that.
Baptists usually are ranked the highest. Now I know for Baptist watching, we've talked about this extensively. There's a huge difference between like Baptist, modern day Baptist, and like, you know, the IVLP or the Duggars, like the independent.
Oh, sure.
There's a huge difference. We grew up with the only difference I see between the friends we grew up with who were Baptists is they got dunked in a pool as a kid with baptism and we didn't. That was really kind of a big difference.
Sure.
But their parents would have a glass of wine with you and they did not practice quiverful like the Duggars do.
And we danced and had fun.
right. And that's mm-hmm. a very extreme opinion on the Anabaptists, which the Anabaptists are their basic belief was that you have to be old enough to consent to baptism, which is why they do it older versus other denominations like us that do it as babies. So, and you can see, like, I've been studying Bill Gothard and the IBLP, which,
mm-hmm.
and
I like
the Duggars. I watched, we watched their show together.
I've always kind of admired them, but gosh, lately.
Some of that stuff they teach, though.
Some of the stuff coming out, it's kind of like, I'm taking a second look.
At this, it's not, it seems to me as an outsider looking in, they focus more on the Old Testament laws versus mm-hmm. the New Testament laws, which are very, very, very different. Mm-hmm. And there's a difference between submitting to your husband and being kind of enslaved to your husband.
Right.
And these types of families. And so, and that doesn't say like, I really do like a lot of the Duggar kids. I think I still watch the show.
Absolutely.
And I said this on this show, like, I don't blame the IBLP for Josh's issues, even though they mm-hmm. might have helped his issues fester. Mm-hmm. Josh is a full grown adult and he is responsible for his own issues. So how many people at our church did weigh down with you? Cause I remember you going to the meeting.
Yeah. I go to a meeting once a week, probably about 20. And I know I lost about 20 pounds. I was shocked at how quickly, you know, the weight came off. You know, of course, like any other diet I've been on, did I maintain it? No. But it was mostly about just eating when you're hungry and portion control. And I know, Bryce, you're always really good about portion control. I really think that's the secret. I do believe that at the end of the day, it's calories in versus calories out. And, you know, so the way she taught it was you just aren't going to get a lot of calories in. And that, therefore, you're burning more calories than you're eating. So, therefore, you're going to lose the weight. But, you know, when I do the intermittent fasting, I really do feel better when I go for periods of time without eating. But like you said, my body can handle it. I know, you know, some people can't handle that. So there was a lot about the program that I really like. I'll never forget, and I don't know if you saw this on the video, she talked about that, you know, God wants us to enjoy the food on this earth. And she was saying, you know, back in the olden days, she was talking about how much she loved Fritos. And she said, don't you think when they made the corn, got cornmeal and, you know, made some patties or whatever with corn, it was kind of like eating Fritos, I guess. But, you know, that stuck in my head. It's like, I like Fritos and I'm not going to deny myself a Frito, but I just have to watch how much of it I eat. And that kind of stuck with me. It's like, you know, that makes sense. Don't eat the whole bag. Just eat a little bit of it. That's a problem with me, though. Once I get started, it's hard for me to stop.
Well, and I know, too, like, she talks about a lot about whatever food you're craving, go eat it, which is great for people who don't have stomach issues. But, like, you know, I was born with horrible stomach issues, which I've talked about on this channel. Now I know it has a lot to do with blood types. And you even talked about when I was a kid, just a baby, just having just awful digestive system. And in my 30s, I've learned how to manage it for the most part, because I have to, I know that sometimes I'll crave something to eat, but I know if I eat it, I'm going to have a bad stomach. And so again, that kind of goes into the individual person. Like, you might crave something, but you know, if you eat it, your body's not going to be able to digest it. So again, kappas are usually really good at digesting things. And so like your disposition is better at that. And I think that's kind of where she was teaching to people who could like live a little bit freer. And that was the thing I really liked about her. What she was saying is it offered people this sense of freedom that they could just live their life and not be like tied down to a diet. And
exactly. That's what I said. It gave you freedom. If everybody we're stopping by a fast food store on the way to the beach, you know, it gave me the freedom to say, okay, I can eat a half of a hamburger and a handful of French fries and it's okay. You know, it's like, I can't go there because they don't have any diet food for me. You know, it does give you that sense of freedom. And, you know, that's how your Aunt Debbie has, I mean, she does intermittent fasting. She only eats during a window, you know, and she's kept her weight off all these years, but she doesn't deny herself anything she wants. She just watches her proportions and only eats during a small period of time. So it gave me freedom, and I liked that about it. So
one thing I noticed from her videos, did she ever speak about getting like people who had eating disorders, whether it was overeating or undereating, going and seeing a therapist to help them?
I don't remember that. Did you see that?
What I get from her is she thought you could just like pray it away, like just go to God in prayer when you were having cravings. And I know that now in the 2020s, we understand more about the brain, and that sometimes we need to see, I mean, I loved my therapist that I went to. We need to see a therapist. And this is one problem that I have a lot with like conservative churches sometimes, is that when you have a member of the church that has like cancer, the church will pray for that person and for their doctor, you know, understanding that prayer can't be that alone. They have to also have a doctor helping them.
Sure.
But they don't see the same thing with people who have some mental issues, that they need to go see a secular therapist as well to help them, because the brain is an organ, just like the colon is.
Yeah. Great point.
And I think that a lot, like some of the cons I've seen to her program is that it kind of enabled people who have, and I don't think I can say the word on YouTube, the A word, who have a propensity to starve themselves. It kind of enabled that, because on her
website, I can see that.
It does say that this diet can help you with an eating disorder, but I you know, the less you eat, the less your stomach's going to growl. Your body will, you know, adapt to what you're giving it. And so that was one of the downfalls. And I've said it in the first part over and over again, like, especially if you overeat too, that's an addiction, especially if it's to the point where you are really endangering your health. You know, you probably need some medical intervention with that as well, with a therapist to help you figure out what it is. It's just like a drug addiction.
Yeah, it is.
You wouldn't try to pray in a way. You would send a person to rehab, you know?
Yeah.
It's only like food, but you can't live without food, but you can live without drugs. So it's a different beast altogether.
Yeah, so that's the part about it.
That was an issue some people had, is that she kind of neglected the mental aspect to addiction, whether undereating or overeating as well, and people getting that type of help to figure out why they're doing it and to process that. I have a question too, and I know that this is going to cause a lot of controversy. And once again, if you're in the comment section, just please be respectful to each other. I said this over and over and over again. We as finite people cannot understand an infinite God. So every denomination, every person's perspective on religion, whether it's Christianity, is their own opinion. No one's right. Mm-hmm. No one's wrong. No one has all the answers. So please be respectful to people in the comment section. But one thing that got Gwen Shamblin in a lot of trouble in the late 90s, and what caused her Way Down program to kind of get kicked out of churches, was that she denied the Trinity. Now, in my opinion, that is not that big of a deal. It's tomatoes, tomatoes, because she did believe that Jesus was the Son of God. In all aspects of the word Christian, she was a Christian. She just did not believe that the Father, Son, Holy Ghost existed as one. And her excuse was that it doesn't say it in the Bible. that it says it nowhere in the Bible. And a lot of churches got really upset about that and kicked her program mm-hmm. out, which in my opinion, I mean, I think I'm a little open-minded, like tomatoes, tomatoes, like she still believes, she's still a Christian. It's just a different mm-hmm. perspective. And sometimes I think that if the churches had not done that, she would not have gone off the deep end with then starting her own church, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
the church is doing that and kicking somebody out because they have one little difference in opinion mm-hmm. to me is CULT behavior. That's what CULT is doing.
Yeah.
High religious or she wasn't denying the Christian faith, which the Christian faith is believing Jesus was the Son of God. That's mm-hmm. that's the crux of it. It's just a different opinion. Episcopalians, yeah. Presbyterians, Methodists, Baptists all have different opinions of the same religion. So what are your thoughts on that?
You know, religion's a tricky thing. I think religion is an individual mm-hmm. relationship with Christ. Do I believe in the Trinity or do I believe that that was not a good reason to kick her out?
Well, I mean, I know you believe in the Trinity, but like,
yeah.
did you know that? And what is your reaction to that? And does it change your
opinion? I didn't know that. And it would be interesting for me to go back and do some research on that. But, I'm just trying to remember in my mind some of the videos. I'm sorry. Do you hear Maggie? Are you sure it's okay?
No, it's fine. Everybody watching has dogs. Most of them
okay.
do. So it's fine. Okay. They hear Robbie barking them.
She gets anxious when I'm not around her. Now I forgot what you're asking
about the Trinity and Gwen.
I do remember her. She really would have whatever belief she had. She would have scripture to back it up. You would see her sitting in a chair, if I recall, mm-hmm. with her Bible open and say, you know, this is what the Bible says about this, or this is what the Bible says about that. So I know that she was a biblically based Christian. You know, I do believe that she, you know, read scripture and made decisions from that. But, you know, it's kind of like you said, it's the different religions, Catholic, Protestant, whatever.
It's different.
But I think that basically, if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that he is your, you know, he's our salvation. I think that's the bottom line, really.
Right. That's kind of how I felt too. Like when I was reading that, I was like, this is ridiculous. Like mm-hmm. this is ridiculous. Like that they would kick her out, especially if her program was helping people. Why would the church get rid of it? If it, just because of that one thing that she has a different opinion on, it wasn't, I don't think she was forcing anybody to believe what she believed. She just said that she didn't find any evidence in the Bible that they were three in uh-huh. one. And it's interesting.
Yeah.
If you look at the Council of Nicaea, a lot of these things that are taught as dogma in the church now were decided in the fourth century. So we don't even know what the early Christians actually believed when it came to that. Because over 2,000 years, of course, things are going to change and evolve and all that kind of stuff. So I thought that was absolutely ridiculous, but I can't understand how some evangelical churches, because in my opinion, some evangelical churches can be a little bit on the violent side when it comes to not physically, but like emotionally, mentally on that's just my opinion. It's just from what I've witnessed. They can be a very, ABUSIVE to other people who have a slightly different perception, mm-hmm. Which is not okay. In my opinion, that's kind of satanic to be that way to people. That's not of God.
Jesus's main thought was to love one another,
right?
To love each other, as you know, and that's the bottom line is just love Jesus and to love one another and accept people for their differences. And
oh, you froze up a little bit, Mom.
I think I lost you, Bryce.
Can you see me? I can see you. You just froze up.
Hello.
Can you hear me? Mom? Okay. Can you hear me? See me?
Sorry. It says our internet connection's unstable. This house has terrible internet. I apologize.
That's okay. It's an old house.
But yeah, I just think that, you know, we should just, you know, love one another, honestly. And, you know, you don't have to accept everybody's beliefs, and everybody's beliefs can be different, but that doesn't mean you still can't love them.
And then you're still the same religion. Like, it's still the same religion.
Right.
You know, still the same Bible. That's what kind of just drives me crazy. So how did it end at our church? When did the program stop?
It was just maybe a 12-week program or a 6-week program where we went, you know, once a week, and they just did it that one time. And they may have done it a couple of times. I can't remember, but I just did it that one time. Yeah. It was just, you know, a short little program.
And I remember, I won't say your name because I don't want to dox anybody, but I remember the woman who led it at our church.
I don't even remember that.
Her husband taught at Darlington. I don't want to say her name because,
I know.
And I remember her being super excited about it because she didn't have to exercise anymore.
Oh, that's funny.
And I remember her saying something at the school, we went to a private school.
I remember that now. Yeah.
And she was just super excited that she didn't have to, I think her husband was like a long distance runner or something, but she was super excited that she didn't have to exercise. Like, I'm free of having to do this.
Right.
So now how did you feel when you found out she had died in a plane crash?
Well, you know, I haven't really kept up with her through the years, but I remember you telling me a while back, Mom, you know, the lady that started way down is very controversial. And so you're the one that kind of told me about that. But that's been a while since you told me that. You know who actually told me about it? Bill. He was looking on Facebook or somewhere, and he said, Alice, do you know who this, you know, Gwen
Shamblin
is with Way Down? And I said, oh yeah, I did her program before. And he's the one that said, well, she was killed in a plane crash. I said,
So I stumbled upon the controversy around her when I was doing research into some of these other fringe groups, and she popped up. And again, I know I've read a lot of the allegations that people have towards some of the stuff that maybe she's done. Maybe her Remnant Fellowship Church became a high controlled religious group. I understand that, but there's a lot of gray there. I feel like there was a case back in the early 2000s here in Georgia, Georgia versus Smith, where a couple was charged with a felony murder for their kid. He was basically, corporal punishment had been used on him with glue sticks, which apparently they were part of the Remnant Church, and they claimed that the church had suggested that use of I'm trying to be careful what I say on YouTube.
Yeah, I understand, but
bearing the rod and spoiling, you know, that kind of stuff.
Right.
And the Shamblins actually paid for their bail and paid for their legal fees. The church paid for everything for them. And the church was raided in 2004 in connection to this case, but the police did not find anything in the church that would tie them to this case. The parents were just members of the church. But people kind of took that and ran with it because, of course, the punishment of children is a very touchy subject with people. I don't even know what I believe anymore when it comes to that because, you know, different children, I'm sure, have different reactions to different forms of punishment. But the whole thing was that their church taught to use hot glue sticks, not hot, but because it wouldn't leave marks, was the whole thing. And it became the glue stick case. But she always denied it. And I saw a lot of interviews with her where she frankly was like, we do not support this. Like, you know, you have to discipline your kid, but not to this. It's like, we do not support that. And so I don't really know because I don't know her. I don't know anybody. I've asked for anybody who was a part of the church to contact me if they have any stories they want to share, good or bad. I know that it seemed that their church was very community-based. Like, a lot of the weddings in the church looks like were held actually at her house. And she has a beautiful old Southern home in Tennessee. Like I said, when you think of these like fundamentalist groups, I would not call them fundamentalist. They wear tank tops, jeans, shorts. There's none of that modesty type of stuff. She wore tons of makeup. Her hair got crazy towards the end there. It got real big towards the end there. But
closer to God, the higher the hair, closer to God.
When I said this earlier, when I was listening to some of her videos from the 90s, like, she reminded me a lot of like a friend's mom growing up, just the way she had that Southern drawl,
good Southern accent.
Very well educated. And her father was a surgeon, just like your dad. And, you know, she came from a medical family, just like your family. And so there are a lot of similarities with her family and our. And so maybe that's why I don't feel as quick to say, oh, this was bad because
Bill
Gothard, because there is a lot of gray there. And I do feel a commonality with her. And she was funny talking about her love of food. you know, and her love of chicken salad, and like, what'd she say on Larry King? My God is the God of brownies, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So yeah. And I just think, and I don't know, you know, maybe she did get a little bit into her own power and maybe there was some megalomania there. I don't know. I don't really feel like I have enough information to say yay or nay on the topic, but of course a lot of people are very, 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 very condemning of the diet, which we have this whole body positivity movement happening right now, which is good and bad at the same time, because they're enabling people to stay in a very unhealthy situation.
Sure. So,
you know, I don't know. Do you think that she was a little kooky, or could you see signs of that when you were doing the program?
No, not really. I thought she was very interesting. I thought she was a great orator. You know, she was funny. I mean, I thought she was cute. I don't know. I never thought anything negative about the program. I actually liked it. So, you know,
and you heard nothing about her church, no whispers about her church or.
No. And I will say this too. You think about the era that in the '90s, we didn't have access to, you know, the internet as much as
well,
we
her
do
church
now.
And was all open that in 2004. Stuff. Her church opened
in 2004. Okay, so I did it before she opened her church.
She's made that statement about the Trinity, I believe, in 1999. And she started the church technically in 1999, but the big church you see now didn't open until 2004.
The videos
I've seen, it just really looks like a normal Protestant church, in my opinion. Yeah. People say she opened it as an extension of her Way Down program, and she tried to incorporate the philosophy behind Way Down and a lot of other aspects of life, too, which... you know, whatever. I mean, yeah, you're listening to your body. It's all really, it's common sense, you know, so you can't really judge her for that. And I know there was some scandal. She did get divorced in 2018 and apparently remarried really quickly to the guy who played Tarzan in the 90s. And so there was some, like, scandals around. I just found one article that talked about this, but I don't have anything, you know, verified, but it was a very quick remarry. So there was some interesting stuff around that as well, but, you know, obviously they believe in divorce. Obviously,
that's true.
They're divorced.
You know what? Anytime anybody dies, or tragically, especially like that, that must have been a horrible, you know, way to die. You do feel bad for the family, and you hope that they're doing okay and the survivors.
You know where they were going, apparently.
Where?
I'm going to have to spell this. They were going to an MAGA rally. so we have that in common.
Well, good for them. I always liked her.
So, I will say her daughter, Elizabeth, her husband was also in the plane with her mom, and they have four small kids. And that's heartbreaking, because her daughter is probably around my age.
Yeah.
And they have four small kids, and she lost her mom
and her husband. That's terrible.
In one.
Yeah.
One swoop. And her son was not on the plane. So the kids are both still here. And their dad, apparently, from what I've read, is still really involved in the church, and actually is the one that released Gwen's obituary, her ex-husband, when it was confirmed that she did not survive the crash. So they still have their dad to help them. And so I have seen a lot of channels go out there and totally just berate her as a malicious, maniacal leader, not realizing that her daughter now has lost her mom and her husband, and has four small kids to raise now by herself.
Yeah.
And she's probably in her 30s, maybe early 40s. So she's not old. So that's really tragic. You know, thank God, you know, obviously they're wealthy, so she's not going to probably have to worry about
finances,
but that is extremely shocking.
Yeah.
And we've lost a lot of family members through sickness.
Yeah.
And sometimes I feel like when a family member dies through sickness, it's almost easier, because there's a preparation period.
Sure. You can say your goodbyes.
You can grieve and you can really process it. But when somebody dies so suddenly like that, I that they must be going through a lot of shock and trauma at the same time. Those kids lost their grandmother and their dad.
Yeah.
Both their grandmother and their dad. So that's very, very, very tragic. And I really
So our prayers go out to that family. Yeah.
Very sad for them. So, well, if you do weigh down again, will you come back and tell everybody
sure. how you're doing it? How I'm you're... thinking about it, actually. You've kind of gotten it in my mind.
Oh, well, I've seen a lot of other people say, I think I'm going to go back on my diet again because.
So I'll let you know. I'll keep you posted. Maybe I'll do a little, for a month, do a little test to see how it goes.
Well, if you want to video your progress every day, I'll create a playlist on the channel for you.
All right.
So people can videotape it.
Okay. All right. I'll do that for sure.
And again, I want to reiterate that neither my mom nor I are doctors or nutritionists. So if you are looking at diet plans, please go talk to your doctor first.
Sure.
Before taking any, even if we both said that we kind of like her philosophy, just go talk to your doctor to make sure you don't have any hypoglycemia or anything that might be agitated by some of the symptoms. And in my perspective, like I said, I think she would be the type that would say, okay, well, if you notice that you start spacing out first, that's your body's way of telling you it's time to eat.
Exactly. I was thinking that when you said that earlier, that you got to listen to your own body. That is your body saying, I need to eat something.
And I know for me, and probably I can't go a long period of time without food. Mm-hmm. I have to eat every couple of hours. Because of that. So please, if you like the philosophy, again, go talk to your doctor first to make sure that, and if you do feel like you have an addiction to food or any type of eating disorder, please go seek a therapist to help you.
Because
your brain is an organ, just like your heart, just like your lungs, just like your colon, and any type of mental illness is an illness, just like your other organs. And there are great doctors and great therapists out there that can really help you work through that, because you can't stop eating.
Well, it's good to see you.
Yes, Mom. I wasn't, to all my people watching, I wasn't planning on filming in Florida, but this all happened. Actually, the day that Gwen Shamblin lost her life was the day that our family got a new life in it.
Oh.
So,
can't wait for you to meet her. She's beautiful.
We have a new, my mom has a new little grandbaby.
Yeah.
Little chubby little girl.
She's a cutie pie.
And she came into the world a few hours after Gwen left the world. So,
that's way good. Wonderful. Circle Y. Well, I love you, honey.
Thanks, Mom. Love you too. Bye.
Bye.